the shadow of downtown Chicago lies the Lower West Side, a Mexican community called Pilsen, one of the city's 86 neighborhoods. Walking Pilsen streets, you can see reflections of many American communities, high unemployment and low income, houses reduced to rubble, and young men with nothing to do. But in Pilsen, there is more to see than that. There are children playing in the pump on a hot day, a store that specializes in chile and chicharrones, Saturday afternoon wedding, a tortilla factory, and a restaurant serving huevos con chorizo for breakfast. Pilsen is an immigrant community with a Polish, Czech, Lithuanian, and Jewish legacy. And now it is Mexican immigrants that call Pilsen home, like the family of Teresa and Refugio Fraga of West Cullerton Avenue.
My husband's brother and family on the second floor. My husband's brother and family on the first floor. A friend, she lives here. And then I live here.
And that's what Pilsen has always been, a port of entry. Northern Mexico, rugged, green, fertile, but with too few jobs for too many people. Every year, thousands leave Mexico looking for work, and like all immigrants, they take little with them, except hope and memories. Like Teresa Fragas.
We lived in a small town. We knew everybody. It was nice. There were a lot of things that we wanted, but yet were content. I would say that I was happy. I think that everybody leaves trying to have more than what they have. You know, jobs in Mexico is what separates families. My father left first to look for a job in the United States. And then he came back 3 years later to bring us. I didn't understand then why we were coming to the United States.
Qué cerca de los Estados Unidos, qué lejos de Dios. How close to the United States, how far from God.
To you, this is an international boundary, right? That's the dividing line between two sovereign nations. To you, it's an entirely different world over there. To these people here, it's the same thing. This is just a span that they have to cross.
Our main concern with the aliens is not along this border here. They can move freely up and down the border within a 25-mile limit. Once they pass that 25 miles away from the river and go into the interior of the country, these are the people who are going to stay in the United States. They're there, they've become permanent residents. The unemployment rate in Mexico, it's 40%, approaching 50%. As the economy in Mexico keeps going downhill, we're going to get more of these people over here. Take a look. How could you keep them out? How can you keep these people out? And you got like 1,500 miles of river, of border.
I remember vividly when we crossed the river, because the ones who were doing it illegally. And we were coming illegally. Nobody knew like that we were crossing the river. I think that everybody leaves because there is something more over there.
And as for so many who leave Mexico, Teresa Fraga's family found work where another hand is always needed, in the fields of Texas. And later, when she married Refugio, they became migrant workers.
When we were migrant workers, we lived anywhere. Anywhere. There was a large barn that other families shared. And my husband and I had just been recently married, had no children, so, you know, we had to stay in the chicken coop because it was more private. We couldn't fit standing up, but we cleaned it up and everything. You miss a lot of that, you know,
Mother Nature stuff, you know, the sun, working in the rain, working in the wind. As long as the harvest lasts, that's how long we would stay, and we would be packing up all the time. Somebody told us, you know, stop in Chicago, at least your job is going to be more stable.
And Dallas. Connection in Corpus Christi for St. Louis and Chicago.
We never stopped to think what we had or what we're leaving behind.
Good morning. This is WBMX News. Now 60 degrees in the loop. I'm Mike Allen. Governor Thompson says the issue of jobs is at the bottom line of this year's presidential election contest.
WBBM News Time 9-11. Herb, how are we doing on the expressways now?
On the expressway system, the Kennedy from Cumberland to Ohio, now an 18-minute trip. 9 minutes in the regular lane from the junction to Ohio.
When I came here, I didn't even pay attention to the name of the street. I didn't pay attention to how long this block was or how it looked. I wasn't even looking at the city as a whole or at the community as a whole. I didn't even see it as a Mexican community. I guess what was hard is to try to understand, you know, or to be understood by your neighbor who thinks that your kids are making noise and, you know, your kids are on the fire escape and, you know, that. What was hard for me, like for the first 3 months, I was about to deliver. I took a chance and delivered my baby at home because we had no money, no insurance. In a way, that was hard because you're in a different setting.
It was hard because we don't know nothing around mm-hmm. this area. This is one thing, it was hard for us because every time we want to go out someplace, we don't know the area, we might get lost.
Before, I would be around the community all day long. Something happens, you go in and you hide. You don't want to be part of it. You don't want to see it. You don't want to do anything about it. I think that's different now on this block. Something's happening. I go out there and I try to find out what's going on and do something about it. It's nice to have security in your mind, to know where you're going to go to sleep, and to know that you've slept there for 10 years. You know, that's a good feeling. What's the recipe? Tortillas?
Yeah.
Cheese? Onions as a filling, onions and cheese as a filling, tortillas, chile ancho, and blend it, that's all. I have to make flour tortillas every morning. Not that I have to. He expects them, and I want to do it because this is, you know, a specialty for him that I don't think he's ever going to give up.
For 14 years, Refugio Fraga has worked as a highway construction laborer, a seasonal job that only allows him to work 9 months a year.
He could be working right on the sidewalk of McDonald's. He's got to have lunch from home because his work is important for him, and he feels that I have to be part of that. And if I know what's important for him and he knows what's important for me, then there's no problem.
They were doing real good.
My 20-year-old son just became unemployed at Ryerson Steel. He had been working there 1 year part-time and 2 years full-time.
This is what they call the south plant, the center plant. Right across the street over here. I don't see no friends around.
What if my husband lost his job? Well, my son working gave my husband and myself a lot of assurance. Now we don't have that security.
I leave to work 10 minutes before I start. As a matter of fact, I'd be starting right now if I was working, 3 o'clock.
We have 5 boys. He's the oldest. He's in an important position in the family. So when you have a brother that's working and can buy a car, the others want to grow up to be like him.
Some of my friends are unemployed too, but half the neighborhood. Some of them got fired. Some of them, there's just no work. They just can't find a job. It's always been the same. At least I always seen it the same. I never did like to fight. So as I kept growing up, I just avoided all that stuff. So why should I join a gang? I've been here almost 15 years and I never had a fight. Never. You know, friends who've been shot, they've been killed. They were really into that stuff. And, you know, you hate to see them go, but that's what they were asking for. They're always in trouble, looking for fights.
Whenever I hear somebody got killed that belongs to a gang, and just by having seen their names scribbled on the walls, I it just hits me personal, you know. Like, you know how it is when somebody dies and you know the person is, oh, I knew that person. When I hear about troubles, you know, all over the world, you know, with youth, I really praise my boys in the sense that they're not in trouble, at least, and they're not giving us trouble in turn.
No, my parents are very good to me. I think I'll stay there till the day I get married. And who knows when that will be.
Other people, I think, that don't know Pilsen, that don't have anything in Pilsen, might see it as a bad place to live. And they think that, you know, oh, you live in Pilsen, and especially 18th Street, because they don't see it as Pilsen. You live on 18th Street, that's awful, but how have you survived, you know, with all the gangs there and everything? I think it's okay to feel that way if you can find a better place. I mean, why not?
For some, Pilsen used to be a better place, without the 20% unemployment or the vacant lots where houses once stood.
I was born and raised in the area back in 1922. In those years, it was a great community. People were involved with kids. People were out in each other. Today, there isn't anything like that. The kids don't play sports. There's no place for them to go. People today aren't, for example, motivated to really have to work. When I was a kid, if you didn't work, you were in trouble. You know, my folks couldn't speak the language, and they ended up having to go out in best way they can, you know, survive. And they started fixing buildings and learning skills. And
John Podmajerski's parents were Czechoslovakian immigrants that settled in Pilsen. Podmajerski, a former rehab advisor for the city, is now a private developer working in Pilsen.
The lifestyle has changed. You just can't walk around like you feel, and there's not that kind of pulling together, and people are more kind of stratifying in different directions.
See, when I think that when Mexicans started coming into Pilsen, because I've lived here for 14 years, and when we came to this block, right, there was we could have said it was half and half. It wasn't an all Mexican block. And then we remember what it was like when we were out there, like people would turn the other way, and people weren't too receptive, you know, to us. And we know how our kids were, you know, like kind of put aside or given that kind of look where you're not wanted.
People live here long enough to make a few bucks and move on to a different environment, because the average person does not feel that there's any roots here. I see there's roots because it's a great location. The expressway, within the last 4 years, for example, like I said, there's been a lot of changes. We got Printer's Row, we've got Dearborn Homes, Chinatown's been going wild. All around us has been upgrading. I'm looking for the day when Pilsen becomes part of that upgrading process.
Pilsen is a low-income area where less than 20% of the residents own their own homes. So who is responsible for upgrading the community? Is it families like the Fragas? Private developers like John Podmajerski? Or does the burden fall on larger shoulders?
I think with the mayor's emphasis to the neighborhoods, you're finding a direction of revitalizing all the neighborhoods in the city of Chicago. There are many blocks in Pilsen which will not be, no buildings would be torn down. We hope that we can work out a program which rehabilitation will be the main emphasis in the Pilsen area.
Peter Laporte, an urban planning administrator, is concerned with improving Pilsen. But in a city the size of Chicago, an $8 million budget doesn't go far.
I've walked 18th Street, I walked Blue Island, I walked Ashland, all, you know, the perimeters inside the streets, individual streets. There's a lot of work to be done, I agree. And it all can't be done in 1 year. And that's the thing that's got to be understood, that there's not enough money in the community development program to fund every program in every neighborhood in 1 year. It has to be worked out over a series of programs, series of years.
Look at where the money goes. All you have to do is take a look at, you know, if it comes to parks or if it comes to streets and sidewalks.
The city has, you know, as far as the schools, the park districts, all whatever city agency might invest, they've done nothing here. The city has literally, I hate to use the word, milked this area.
I know the city won't take care of us, for sure, you know. And if they do, it's because we're going to say, hey, you know, raise our hand and say, hey, city, we're here. You have to, this is what we have coming, this is what should happen, and it's not happening.
I think the big concern is comes from within Pilsen, that they feel that they are going to be ousted by profit-making developers.
Well, I tell you, I've learned it's a matter of survival. You know, it's when an area is dying, I mean, you just can't, you start, if you buy a building in a dying area and you fix it, at some point, you know, you spend so much money, at that point you got to charge rent. And if you can't get enough rent to support your investment, then you fade away. You're not there.
If when you have these sections that are already kind of being taken over, how, you know, a block by block or a building by building, and you see the same pattern and the same buyer, then he can easily become an enemy for the fact that he displaces families.
I'll tell you, let me just say up front, I don't think I've ever kicked any family out. Most of the buildings that I have developed have been hovels that would have been torn down by average people. And even this, all this property would have been torn down. I've got pictures before here. It was a disaster. If I hadn't had the experience of seeing beyond, and I hadn't had the urge and desire and the strength to go through with the deals.
He buys a building, he tells the families, I'm gonna fix up. I mean, that's a very good excuse all the time to get rid of your tenants. I have to fix up. They leave, and when he rents it, he doesn't rent it to a family. And we're a community of families.
Podmajerski's rents are in the $200 to $250 a month range. And while this is not extremely high in today's housing market, it still is about two times more than the average Pilsen resident pays for rent. For the people who live in Pilsen now, already saddled with high unemployment, there is a growing fear that they will be forced out with nowhere to go. And if Pilsen should become fully developed, it will no longer be a low-income neighborhood that gives immigrants a foothold.
I like Pilsen. Yeah, I feel it's a port of entry for artists. It's a good environment to do artwork in. I like it because it's a neighborhood as opposed to the condomania of the Near North Side. And the environment that's here is quiet, and they're able to get a lot of work done.
Stan Edwards is a Pilsen resident that lives in a Podmajerski development, created especially for artists. Edwards, a commercial designer, was drawn to Pilsen for one of the same reasons that attracts immigrants, affordable housing.
If an artist makes $12,000 a year down here, that's a lot of money. And that's not a lot of money by American standards today.
I do think that, you know, artists too need a home. I enjoy the artists. They've given me an opportunity to develop property where if I didn't have them, I could never develop these properties because I could never survive the marketplace.
Where can we afford to live? This is where we came first, and this is what we know, and this is where we want to stay.
The only way you're going to fight the slum environment is creativity. You know, you can't do it with government money. You can't do it with, you can't do it with average people. You've got to rise above it.
This piece, the bird and the tiger, was down at Navy Pier in this show sponsored by the city last month. These pieces are hard-edged constructivist style.
Most of the people I talk to when I go to La Panaderia or one of the restaurants up on 18th Street in Nueva León, you're an artist. They like that, and they like to talk to you about it. And if they're from Mexico City, they usually talk about Diego Rivera and Orozco, and they get very interested and excited.
Artist studios are hard to find, and John's done a remarkable job here making these spaces available.
Sure. They have to live too, but you know, what's wrong with us wanting to live? Because it has been, this has been the case all the time, that if we don't look after ourselves, no one's going to look after ourselves. If it were up to the people that live in this community, the future could be good and could be a bright future, could be a future of a community that's going to live longer, unless the city has hidden plans. The thing that holds us here is my husband's job. I think his job is what makes me feel, you know, safe, because at least there's insurance. And because he brings money home every week. That's all we've got. And our kids. You know, I hear a lot of people say, well, you know, you shouldn't sacrifice too much for your kids. Well, what's wrong with that if that makes me happy? I mean, putting food on their table is not a sacrifice. It's a pleasure. You know, making sure that they have clean clothes and they're in a nice street, in a nice community, that's a pleasure. That's not a sacrifice. See, in order for you to become really angry about what's happening to your community, you have to invest in it. When we came here 14 years ago, we had no commitment to anyone because we were planning on going back. Buying a building is making a commitment. We hope that this will be bedrooms up here, and have location and living room downstairs. The building that we bought was built in 1885. I can't believe it, that it's almost 100 years old and that we bought it. When the community looked bad, it was going to be torn down. Now that it sort of looks good because of the efforts of the people that are living here, people want to come back. I guess on every day here on this block, you'll hear a hammer or a saw somewhere.
I'm very happy if a Mexican or Latin or whatever kind of person rehabs, you know, because if he fixes his building, he's reassuring what I'm doing. I see, for example, some of my artists have gone in the area and bought buildings and have been gutting them. What I'm doing here is vacating alleys, turning buildings inward, creating interesting environments, setting up atmospheres and setting up where people can get together and communicate. I'm building in the sense of security and sense of community. And, you know, in assembling buildings, I usually try to buy them, you know, together so I can kind of expand from a central court. For example, there's this piece of property called the Brewery. It's at 18th and Canal. It consists of about 25 buildings. The buildings are small buildings, and they lend themselves ideally for an artist's habitat commercial space kind of thing. It's the kind of thing that's being done in Boston, in New York, in San Francisco.
The way I feel about it being turned into an artist's colony, it won't help the community. See, the artists live five blocks away from where I live. And I don't see them becoming part of the community.
I don't see there's any conflict. There are some people that are trying to create a conflict, but in fact, there is not a conflict. I think there's great, as far as the artists are income level wise, I think a lot of the artists are as poor than anybody around here, you know. And I'm the landlord, you know, I'm probably no better than anybody because I have to collect the rent and I have to deal with these people. Let me say something, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart. If the Brewery is not developed as a housing habitat, which is the most sensible and practical solution, you know, in this time, in our lifetime, this area will be ready for the bulldozer.
But it won't help the community, at least the people that are living there now. And if it's turned into a factory, it will help the people in the community in terms of jobs.
Like I pointed out earlier, over there at 22nd and Racine, there's a brand new modern two-story building with half the space of the Brewery that's been vacant for 3 years. If people were concerned about jobs, that's in the heart of Pilsen. Why weren't they at that time concerned about fixing those, about getting some developers there, about getting government involved with jobs? And let me ask you this, when they saw these industries leaving, why didn't they make an effort then of getting them if they thought that these people were getting jobs? Incidentally, most of the industry here did not employ people in the neighborhood. There's one that still does, Johanna Western, but by and large, they're people from outside the community. Those buildings don't lend themselves to any desirable industrial use. That's why industry has left them. The Brewery's going to make it because I'm a very determined man, and I'll sacrifice anything.
See, in order for you to become really angry about what's happening to your community, you have to invest in it. I've invested time in this community. We want to stay. We need to be here, and so far our family has never been chased out of anywhere. Every time that we have moved because we think that we're moving to something better, and I think that we're in that better place now. At least there's more options, more possibilities. From the day I was born, we've never planned what's going to be 10 years ahead. What I would like to see happen is maybe fix up the building, hope that my husband continues to keep his job so that we can fix it little by little.
But now, when they need a steady income the most, the Fraga's future is in question. There is no job prospect for Herman, and without his additional income, it is impossible to fix up the new house. And like the migrant life they left, highway construction is seasonal work. And this year, there is not as much to do as in previous years. There are many days when Refugio Fraga does not work.
It's also unpredictable. His job is a 9-month, 8.5-month job. And so every winter, we're sort of prepared mentally to say, well, he'll be on compensation for 3.5 months. But when this happens in the middle of the working season, so it's supposed to be right now, and he's not working steady, then I, as the wife, I can't make plans with, even with the groceries, I can't make plans with the payments, I can't make plans for the winter either. I think it's just another blow after Herman being laid off.
I wanted to work steady there, and I had planned to, because the benefits are real good, everything's real good there. And I wanted to keep working there, and just feel bad that it, you know, they laid me off.
Well, we can change. I don't think that there's anything we can do to change that situation with work being so slow. I think we are at a point that we don't, if we were to move on, I wouldn't know what to do next or where to go next.
Many times it's up to the individual. It's up, like up to us. We could be in the mountains of Washington still, or we could be picking tomatoes in Ohio. You know, we could have been on welfare. I think it's up to the individual, no matter where you're at, what country you're at.
$1.5 million immigrants from all over the world cross borders into the United States every year. The port of entry may change. The movement of people never will.
Take a look. How could you keep them out? How can you keep these people out? And you got like 1,500 miles of river, of border.